back-to-back-to-back exclusives. First up, Jeb Bush, livid over Donald Trump's comments about his brother.
When you talk about George Bush, I mean, say what you want, the World Trade Center came down during his time.
Jeb's response, next. Then, one-on-one with Hillary Clinton, weighing in on Bernie, Benghazi, and 40 years with Bill.
I'm not going to sit here and tell you it's been, you know, a path filled with rose blossoms.
Does she think it's decision time for Joe Biden? Then, another exclusive, Mitt Romney. The would-be president weighing in on his party's chances to win the White House.
I would vote for the nominee of the Republican Party, and I don't believe that's going to be Donald Trump.
Hello, I'm Jake Tapper in Washington, D.C., where the State of Our Union is exclusive. Today we're bringing you three blockbuster interviews with marquee names from both parties, Bush, Clinton, and Romney. First up, former Florida Governor Jeb Bush, once seen as the inevitable GOP nominee, now stuck in the middle of the pack, trailing behind Donald Trump. This week, Trump got personal, saying this about Bush's brother.
When you talk about George Bush, I mean, say what you want, the World Trade Center came down during his time. If you look
Hold
at
on,
Sandy
that,
Hook,
you can't blame George Bush for that.
He was president, okay? Don't blame him or don't blame him, but he was president. The World Trade Center came down during his reign.
That comment sparked a Twitter war with Jeb Bush, calling Trump pathetic. Trump just minutes ago responded saying, quote, Jeb Bush should stop trying to defend his brother and focus on his own shortcomings and how to fix them. Now here with us in the flesh to respond is former Florida Governor Jeb Bush. Governor, thanks so much for being with us.
Thanks, Jake.
So what are you objecting to about Mr. Trump's remarks about 9/11 and your brother?
Look, my brother responded to a crisis, and he did it as you would hope a president would do. He united the country, he organized our country, and he kept us safe. And there's no denying that. The great majority of Americans believe that, and I don't know why he keeps bringing this up. It doesn't show that he's a serious person as it relates to being commander-in-chief and being the architect of a foreign policy. Across the spectrum of foreign policy, Mr. Trump talks about things that as though he's still on The Apprentice. I mean, literally, talking about Syria, saying ISIS should take out Assad, then Russia should take out ISIS as though it was some kind of board game and not a serious approach. This is just another example of the lack of seriousness, and this is a serious time. We're under grave threats again, and I think we need a president with a steady hand.
To play devil's advocate, do you think it's at all possible that your loyalty to your brother, while very admirable on a personal level, might be in some ways a political or policy liability blinding you to mistakes he made?
No, I mean, so next week Mr. Trump is probably going to say that FDR was around when Japan attacked Pearl Harbor. It's what you do after that matters, and that's the sign of leadership. Does anybody actually blame my brother for the attacks on 9/11? If they do, they're totally marginalized in our society. It's what he did afterwards that matter, and I'm proud of him, and so are a bunch of other people. You don't have to have your last name named Bush to be able to understand that. And it just calls into question Mr. Trump's credibility as a commander-in-chief and an architect of the next generation foreign policy, which we desperately need in this country right now.
Obviously, Al-Qaeda was responsible for the terrorist attack of 9/11. But how do you respond to critics who ask, if your brother and his administration bear no responsibility at all, how do you then make the jump that President Obama and Secretary Clinton are responsible for what happened at Benghazi?
Well, it's the question on Benghazi, which is hopefully will now finally get the truth to, is, was the place secure? They had a responsibility in the Department of State to have proper security. There were calls for security. It looks like they didn't get it. And how was the response in the aftermath of the attack? Was there a chance that these four American lives could have been saved? That's what the investigation is about. It's not a political issue. It's not about the broad policy issue. Is were we doing the job of protecting our embassies and our consulates? And during the period, those hours after the attack started, could they have been saved?
Well, that's kind of proving the point of the critics I was just asking about, because you don't want to have your brother bear responsibility for 9/11, and I understand that argument, and Al-Qaeda is responsible, but why are the terrorists not the ones who are responsible for these attacks in Libya?
They are. Of course they are. But if the ambassador was asking for additional security and didn't get it, that's a proper point. And if it's proven that that the security was adequate compared to other embassies, fine, we'll move on.
Now, you're making some very strong statements about Donald Trump in this interview this morning. You just put out a new web ad, in fact, attacking Trump, saying he's not serious. Let's play a clip from that. Now, the ad goes on to highlight or lowlight, depending on your point of view, of Trump's moments in which I'm sure you would argue he is not being serious. In light of this new ad, let me re-ask you what I asked at the last debate. Do you feel comfortable with Donald Trump's hand on the nation's nuclear codes? Your ad seems to be stating very clearly that you do not. You invoke the number of nuclear weapons the United States has.
I have grave doubts, to be honest with you, and it's only because of the things he says. It looks as though he's not taking the responsibility, the possibility of being president of the United States really seriously. For him, it looks as though he's an actor playing a role of a candidate for president, not boning up on the issues, not having a broad sense of the responsibilities of what it is to be a president. In his own words, it gives me great concern for sure, and a lot of other people will as well.
Why do you think he continues to do so well with Republican voters?
Look, he's a phenomenal personality for sure, and he's capturing people's deep anger and angst about Washington, D.C., for sure. But he's not going to be able to solve these problems. He's mirroring people's anger, and he does it very effectively. I don't think Trump's going to win the nomination. I think we're going to have a nominee that will unite the party and win the presidency. But when people begin to think about who's going to be president of the United States, who has the judgment and the seriousness and the ideas to be president to lead us in a different direction, I think that his support will wane.
What makes you think he's not going to get the nomination? He's been leading in the polls now for months. I just, as a political reporter, I don't see any evidence that he's not going to get the nomination.
We'll see. We'll see, Jake. I mean, this time 4 years ago, this time 8 years ago, the conditions were very different, and the nominee emerged in the January and February timeframe, and I expect that that'll be the case again this time.
After campaign fundraising numbers were put out this week, your spokesman, Tim Miller, had a rather arch comment about your former protege, Senator Marco Rubio. Miller tweeted, quote, lying about budgets, guess Marco picked up something in the Senate. Them's fighting words, Governor.
Yeah, I'm not into all that, but he kind of misled people about his fundraising results. That's fine. Look, the process part of this is not my motivation to run. I believe we can grow our economy at a far faster rate and have a set of concrete plans to do that. And I think on foreign policy, we've done the exact same thing. So each and every day that I campaign, I focus on those things.
You probably watched some of the Democratic debate the other night. You want to be the Republican that takes on the nominee, still likely to be Hillary Clinton, according to polls. How did she look to you? Did she look tough? Did she look beatable?
She looked beatable because of the ideas she embraced. She did a good job in the debate, for sure. She's a smart person, no doubt about that. But every chance she had to lay out a different approach than the one we're on now, she actually doubled or tripled down on it. More taxes, more regulation, more creating barriers on people's ability to rise up. I think there'll be a stark contrast. If I'm elected the Republican nominee, it will be a stark contrast of, do you believe in the country's future with a hopeful, optimistic message that gives people capacity to achieve earned success, or should we manage the decline? And I'm excited about that.
Donald Trump just pushed CNBC to commit to limiting the next Republican debate to 2 hours. Now, this week, in addition to releasing your campaign finance records and your plan to repeal and replace Obamacare, you also released your medical records with indications that you are in good shape. You have a, quote, capacity to complete high-intensity physical activity. So it sounds like you would be at least physically up for 3 hours of debate, or are you good with two?
I can do three. I can do two. Whatever they decide, I'm ready to go. I could do four if forced to. But that would be that mentally, that might be too much.
Well, best of luck at that debate, and we hope to see you out there on the campaign trail. Governor Jeb Bush, thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Jake.
There's even more from our Jeb Bush interview. You can find it on CNN.com/SOTU, State of the Union. Check it out. Coming up, Vice President Biden's 2016 announcement could come any minute. Is Hillary Clinton's campaign trying to force his hand? Stay with us.